did you be the one to come to introduce the term archon into the current discourse, and how do you feel, what is your concern about how the term is being used these days?
The Gnostic materials that survive in Nag Hammadi are pathetic and fragmentary, and other ex-Nag Hammadi, non-Nag Hammadi materials are also very meager. Historical truth is that the Gnostic message to mankind is the most suppressed message that has ever existed on this planet. So I'd just like you to think about that, that there is something in the Nag Hammadi teachings that somebody doesn't want humanity to know about. And they have taken brutal measures through centuries to see that this message has been eradicated. Now, fortunately for us, in December of 1945, some fragmentary documents written in Coptic were discovered in a cave in Egypt and were reconstructed, edited, translated, and they first appeared around 1976 in English, in the so-called Nag Hammadi Library in English. I've always studied mystical and esoteric subjects through my life, and I have practiced certain forms of experimental mysticism with and without the use of psychoactive plants. And so I had a certain amount of interest in finding out what was in these rare Gnostic materials. And up until that time, around the middle of the 70s, I didn't know that much about what the content and the message of Gnosticism was. No one did, because as I said, there was a centuries-long campaign to destroy that message. Well, I was terribly intrigued. I bought the Nag Hammadi Library in English when it first came out, and I couldn't make head or tails of it. And I can tell you today that anyone reading it or buying it today,
it's gibberish.
You find little bits in there. There's little bits of stuff in there that I was seeing, and what you've done is bring it all together, and that's why I admire your work so much. So please go on.
Well, it's true that I am the sole scholar of Gnosticism who stands out for two reasons. One is that I am not of the Judeo-Christian tradition. Most of the scholars who have translated and interpreted the Gnostic materials are historians of religion, or if they're experts in the Coptic language, their background is going to be in the Judeo-Christian tradition, and only accepts a Christian slant of Gnosticism. Gnostic materials from Nag Hammadi were sort of like, you know, lost gospels, right? They were maybe unedited versions of the New Testament that ought to have been included maybe in the New Testament, but they were cut out for some reason. Well, that is completely misleading. The Gnostic writings, Gnostic philosophy, cosmology, parapsychology, the Gnostic theory of ethics, and the Gnostic profile of the archons, which we're coming to in a moment, are all entirely unique and outside the realm of Christian theology and Christian Judeo-Christian beliefs. And so I am the only scholar who is a Gnostic who has attempted to tell the world what the Gnostics wanted to say. And secondly, I am the only scholar who has restored in its entirety the myth of the divine Sophia, who was a goddess, if you will, in the Gnostic view of the world, in their mythology, which was not a mythology in the sense of lies, but it was a mythology in the sense of a grand scenario of imagination that carries a transcendent truth about humanity, about our origin, and about the origin of the earth itself. The single most important factor in the Nag Hammadi writings is the narrative of the goddess Sophia. And I call that, for reasons which will become obvious, the fallen goddess scenario. So I restored that. It wasn't easy. It was very difficult to do because of the fragmentary nature of the materials. I can't tell you, when people write me at my website or write me on my email who have encountered God in his image and who have read this story, they all say the same thing. And I find that very encouraging that everyone says the same thing. They all say, this is it. This is what I've been looking for. There's something about this story, this narrative of the goddess Sophia, that really clicks totally for me. Go read it. Just go read the story. You can read it on metahistory.org. What I did was I took the Gnostic materials. I was very rigorously faithful to the textual materials that survived, and I reconstructed the story or narrative in 9 episodes. So just go read the story. It's like any other story that you might read, and see how it affects you. Now, when I was reconstructing that story, I became aware of what the story actually was. There is no comparable myth to this anywhere in the material of any culture on the planet. Now, one thing to know, and this is important in understanding where the archons come in to the picture, is that the Sophia myth of the Gnostics is astronomical. What I mean by that is that it is a story, a consistent plot, that describes events that happened, the origin of the human species. It explains the origin of the earth, and it explains the presence in human reality and in our life here on earth, the presence of a predatory mind parasite called the Archon. Now let me explain to listeners my concern about how this term is being used today. The term Archon, found in the Gnostic writings, is from a Greek word. Even though the Nag Hammadi writings are in Coptic, about 1 in every 4 or 5 words are in Greek, and they are said to derive from Greek originals. So the word archon is a Greek word, and what it literally meant back in the days of Alexander the Great in the Roman Empire, it literally meant governor. So the archon of a certain province of Rome, or the governor of a certain province of Rome, was simply called the archon. And the Gnostics understood it as to mean a ruler or authority. So in a general sense, an archon is an authority who tells you what to do. But in a more specific sense, the Gnostics, who wrote the Nag Hammadi material, who left it to us anyway, had a cosmic view of what an archon is. And that was the specific profile of the archon as an extraterrestrial predatory mind parasite. And the reason why they called these extraterrestrial predatory parasites archons was because the name derives from the Greek word archaea, which means before or from the beginning. And the narrative, the cosmological narrative of Gnosticism, which is the story of the goddess Sophia, describes an event that happened in this galaxy of ours before the Earth was formed. This is a really important point. That's why the archons are called archons, because they were here before the Earth was formed. People out there who are picking up on the idea of the archon are getting a valuable piece of intel that could change their way of seeing the world and could be very empowering for anyone who wants to make a better world and overcome the psychopaths and the control freaks who are running our world. The Gnostics considered the archons to be a primary problem of humanity. The Gnostics were seers and shamans who could look into other dimensions and they could explore through their psychic powers. They were very, very skilled shamans trained in parapsychology, noetics, and the detection of alien forces. And they left a warning for humanity, but humanity didn't get that warning until a little while ago because somebody didn't want humanity to get the warning. The warning was that there exists this horde of predatory ETs, appear in two types primarily. One is a neonate type that appears to be a prematurely born fetus, that is to say, with a spindly body, big head, and bug eyes. You know, that would correspond to the classical gray ET. And the other type of archon, which is the overlord of the gray ET archons, is the reptilian type of archon. And so the Gnostic seers identified these two types a long time ago. The archons do not come from an advanced civilization elsewhere in the galaxy. They are not superior to humanity. In fact, they are inferior to humanity. The Earth is a living planet captured in a non-living or inorganic system, and the archons are inorganic beings. The question then is, well, how do the archons originate? How did these mind parasites come about? According to the Gnostic seers, that they came about due to an accident, due to something that was not intended and not foreseen. And that accident is one of the episodes in this 9-episode scenario of the goddess Sophia, which I've reconstructed. It's a story of things that happened among the gods. Now, according to the Gnostic cosmology, the gods, which they call aeons, A-E-O-N-S, they are powerful forces that are beyond any kind of human or animal form, but they are alive and aware. This is all found in bits and pieces in the Gnostic writings. They create and observe different experiments. For them, a planetary system is a laboratory setting. And so what they do is they set up experiments. They said that we were dreamed up as an experiment by these aeonic gods. The next thing that they explain is that there were two particular aeons who were involved in designing the human genome. These are, as it were, our parents. And they are called Sophia and Theleke. And they are male and female aeons because the gods also have gender. So they created a certain type of humanity. And then they sent that plasm out into the galactic limbs by a process which science recognizes, which is called directed panspermia, so that that plasm could seed itself in different worlds that were arising in the galactic limbs, and in that way, these laboratory experiments could unfold. There's one thing you need to know about the Gnostic eons. They're gods, but they're not omnipotent, they don't know everything, they don't control everything, and they don't have a plan with a beginning and middle and an end. The archons could appear to have human form or could trick us into thinking that they do, because the main technology of the archons is something called, in Coptic, hal, H-A-L, and that word means simulation. The archons have a technology of virtual reality and simulation by which they can persuade human beings and trick human beings into many, many things. And one of the most, helpful aspects of the Gnostic profile of the archons is this business about simulation. Because if you look at the world today, you'll see how humanity is completely caught up in devices of simulation.
Oh, absolutely. Everything we create is like a mirror image of reality. You know, this is almost like the archontic mind. And when you
it is the archontic mind. It is. It's not our mind, because the human animal, the anthropos, was not designed to live in simulation. The anthropos was designed to live in the terrestrial paradise of this planet. The laboratory setting of this experiment is the planet Earth, and all of the creatures living in the planet are part of Sophia's experiment. They're part of the goddess's experiment. But humanity has an exceptional part. It doesn't have a superior part. It has an exceptional part, because we are gifted with intelligence that is similar to the intelligence of the aeons themselves, which is called nous. So we are gifted, according to the Gnostics, with a germ of divine intelligence. But the key is, how do we use that intelligence? If the experiment on this planet were operating properly and hadn't been deviated by the archons, which they can do without invading the planet, they do it through the mind and through telepathy and through devices of deceit and persuasion. But if the experiment we're living in now had not been deviated by them, then we, the anthropos, humanity, would be using our intelligence to live in harmony with the natural world, which is a paradise. This planet is a natural paradise. But we don't live like we're in paradise, do we? We live like we're in a shopping mall, right?
Oh, it's ridiculous.
What were the original designs and purposes of this experiment, and what is the role of humanity in this experiment to make it succeed? All of that leads to solution. The Archons are a problem, and they're a very big problem, and I've talked a great deal about this. Do Archons turn into human beings? No, it's worse than that. Human beings turn into them.
This is what psychopaths are. It's almost like it's a mind that is totally controlled by the Archon mind. I think that there is a great deal to this, and it's very important that people pay attention to the story.
Well, you bring up two really crucial points here, and these points, I tell you, they burn in my soul every day. One point is that the Gnostics and the Teleste, as they call themselves, we who are aimed of the ancient mysteries, used entheogenic plants in order to keep their minds open to the true nature of reality and to the nature of this divine experiment we're in. And so the issue of the correct use, the ritual and correct use of entheogenic plants, sacred plants, not drugs, but the gifts of nature, is extremely important in discussing how we deal with the Archons. There are many, many aspects of solution that can be derived by looking in that direction and using the myth to guide your life and to guide your imagination. That's its purpose.
And that's the thing, isn't it? I mean, the Gnostics, the Telestai, the word Telestai itself means those who are aimed, doesn't it?
Those who are aimed. Such a beautiful term. Those who are aimed.
It is. It is your belief of reality and that the story of who you are that aims you. And when you look at the state of humanity at the moment and the state of this planet at the moment, I don't think we've been aimed in a very good direction. And we're aimed by the myths that guide us. And it's very, very important what myth we're looking at and what story we're buying into. It really is, because this is our future we're creating here, and we are part of it. We are part of history. We're writing history right now, and we often forget that. And I like the word that you used there, was opportunity, because that's what I see all this as. I see this huge awakening that's happening at the moment as opportunity, and it's an opportunity for us to get involved, but we've got to get involved in the real story.
Well, a big part of the solution for humanity, and that is humanity as a whole, and for each one of us individual human animals, is the right use of imagination. And I can assure you that I've spent my whole life trying to understand the dynamics and the operation of human imagination. It is the greatest power that the human animal has. The Gnostics called it the luminous epinoia, and they had a lot to say about the power of human imagination. If you're not using your imagination, somebody else will. And so the question is, how are you going to use it? What are you going to use to direct it? And the Gnostics called themselves Telestai, meaning we who are aimed, because they followed a practice, I call it a visionary practice, in which they trained their imagination within the frame of this story. The purpose of the Sophianic myth is not like any other religious myth or scientific myth or ET fantasy delivered by New Age channelers. No, it is a unique and incomparable story that has the power to guide the imagination of humanity and to aim us to our true purpose, to our true role, and to reveal the nature of the divine experiment that we are in. And the moment for the Gnostic message is now, and more important than ever right now, in order to heal this experiment and to correct this experiment. In fact, the idea of correcting what has gone wrong with the experiment here is even given to us in Gnostic myth. Humanity itself are called to write the last chapter and to complete this myth and to complete this story and carry it forward in the future. This is the only myth that you will find among all the religious narratives of the world that remains open-ended and that invites humanity itself to join the goddess, to join the intelligence of the earth to your intelligence, and to write the continuing chapters of this story. Since this subject of the Archon seems to be the thing that attracts people to the Sophianic story, but there's also an instinct for survival working there. Just like any other animal, we know that there's a predator in our midst. And so when we hear the Archon word, we perk up our ears, you say, we know. But I would say this, that the information about the Archon predator is not going to be helpful unless we eliminate one massive blind spot in the human view of things. And that blind spot is that people, even relatively enlightened people today, still think that the Earth is an inert material body. The Earth is not an inert material body. It is a living being. She is alive, she's intelligent, and she can communicate with human beings. And the Gnostics, the Telestai, communicated with her directly. And it is by connecting and communicating with the living Earth that we can correct this experiment and that we can manage to repel and defeat the Archons. But without that connection to the living Earth, it's not possible.